好寝具，请来床的世界，中正古亭馆，23680055。
世界家具结束营业，没买我会倒。
要买要快，陪售出清，下杀清仓，一件不留，出价就卖。内湖店民权东路6段8号，27913388。三重店重新路5段657号，2999-9933。
We're in a bit of a period time machine here.
In the age of the machine, every decade is defined by its engineering masterpieces. So join me on a journey through time as I experience the great machines that changed people's lives and shaped modern Britain. The 1960s, the decade that generates an instant wave of nostalgia, when Britain emerged from the austere post-war days of the 50s with more energy, money, and a desire for change. The movers and the shakers of the 1960s decided that life wasn't just going to be functional, it was also going to be fun. Cheers. Now there was a growing demand for machines that were faster, cleverer, and preferably incredibly cool. British engineers needed to embrace the spirit of the times with radical thinking and radical machines, with revolution by design. Your starter for 10. Think of a classic 1960s car. I reckon there's a good chance you're probably thinking of one of these. The British Motor Corporation's homegrown Austin 7 or Morris Mini Minor, better known as simply the Mini. With everyone from pop stars to models and actors proud to be behind the wheel, this great little car became the height of chic. Mary Quant even named her new short skirt the Mini in its honor. This was the hip, cool runaround car of the decade. Which is ironic, as the Mini never set out to be trendy. It was built to get Britain out of an oil crisis. In 1956, the UK clashed with Egypt over ownership of the Suez Canal. Oil tankers were banned from using the canal, and the UK was starting to run short of fuel. So the head of the British Motor Corporation, Leonard Lord, set his engineers a challenge to build a car that was smaller, lighter, and therefore less fuel-hungry than their current 50s range. Leonard Lord wanted the new design to be even smaller than their top-selling Morris Minor, just 10 foot by 4 foot by 4 foot high, to use most of the same standard factory parts, and yet still feel spacious for 4 adults and their luggage. Fortunately, working for BMC was Alec Issigonis, the brains behind the Morris Minor. Alec Issigonis was an idiosyncratic and visionary engineer. By this time, he was already a famous car designer, but the Mini would be his finest hour. Issigonis eventually managed to turn this lot into this. A tiny car with an amazing 80% of its total floor space dedicated to the passengers and their luggage, and 22% lighter than the Morris Minor. So how did he achieve it? With this 1952 Morris Minor, you have what was then a standard layout, with the four-cylinder engine in line with the car, with the gearbox behind it under there. But in the Mini, the engine is packed into an area one-third of the size.
To maximise space inside the car, Issigonis turned the engine around and mounted it across the car, or transversely. A perfect solution, except for one major hitch. There's no room for the gearbox.
Where did he put that gearbox? To find out,
I've got to get underneath.
Ah, here it is, underneath the engine, but an integral part of the engine, giving joint oil circulation of engine and gearbox.
His next revolutionary step was to remove the drive shaft from the engine to the back wheels and create the first mass-produced front-wheel drive car in the world. And with no drive shaft running to the rear wheels, he could lower the height of the floor and create more headroom inside. He also increased the interior space by using sliding windows to reduce the thickness of the door.
The space saved by not having a window dropping down into the door was turned into storage, with these side pockets, large enough, or so rumour has it, to fit a bottle of gin. Apparently Isagonis was rather partial to the odd dry martini.
The interior is beautifully minimalist, and his personal touches are everywhere. There's an ashtray as he was a chain smoker, but he liked silence, so there's no radio. After 2 years of development, the Mark I was ready. Weighing just 615 kilograms, it achieved a remarkable 40 miles to the gallon and a top speed of 72 miles an hour, all for just 496 quid. Isagonis called it his charwoman's car. It was an affordable masterpiece for the working classes.
Come on, Minnie, you can do better than this. Ah! God save us. This old pudding stirrer of a gear stick.
But at first, not everyone wanted to be seen in this cheap, funny-looking car.
You always feel slightly comic driving a Mini. I feel comic for some reason. It's like a go-kart, isn't it? You just do that and everyone flies all over the place. It's good, actually. It's tight. Nice one.
But attitudes soon started to change. This great little runaround let you get out and explore the wonders that 60s Britain had to offer.
No, oh, a horse. Oh, hello, hello, hello. Don't look at me like that, all right? That's the only slight problem when you're in a car that's smaller than a cow. sorry, I'm sorry, I've done nothing wrong, we're cow lovers.
Soon the Mini was available in a wide range of different shapes and sizes and became a successful family car. But how did it become one of the great iconic machines of the decade? Isagonis's Mini had caught the eye of another talented engineer, John Cooper. John and his father Charles were famous for pioneering rear-engined cars in Formula One. They looked at the Mini's lightweight frame, low center of gravity and wide track, and saw huge potential to transform it into a racing car. It may not look that different, but this Austin Mini Cooper has three times the power of the Mark I.
On the rally circuit, the engine was up to 1293cc and 110 horsepower. High compression pistons, twin carburettors, disc brakes, bucket seats, and a racing exhaust all made the Mini something of a different animal.
This little racer could hit a top speed of 97 miles an hour, which in a car this small and low to the ground must feel very, very fast. With British rally driver Clive King at the wheel, I'm about to find out how fast. Here we go.
Hey! Oh, you all right?
Yeah, that was a shock.
Thought half of Wales.
No, just bogey solid, don't worry.
I feel like I'm in a super-powered tin can, skating just 4 inches above this rocky gravel road. In 1962, the Mini Cooper entered one of the toughest races in the world, the Monte Carlo Rally, taking on established big guns like Mercedes and Saab.
That was good. Sorry.
The Mini Cooper won the Monte Carlo an amazing three times. A giant killing success that turned Isagonis's Mini into an international superstar. And now, everybody wanted one. BMC's factories cranked up production to over 200,000 a year, and the ingenious revolutionary Mini became one of the greatest icons of all time. 60s Britain saw old values thrown out, people standing up for their rights, and a sexual revolution. Changes reflected in cool new fashions and futuristic space-age designs. In fact, the whole country was getting a facelift.
It's a good place to be.
I've always said that if you protect the ocean, you protect yourself.
少女谢库斯托海洋探险，星期三晚上10点，国家地理频道。由马尔蒂夫充满阳光的生活赞助播出。Drums keep pounding a rhythm to the break. La-di-da-di-dee. La-di-da-di-da. Charleston was once the rage I had. Teeny Bopper is our newborn king I had. And the beat goes on.
The Champs-Élysées in Paris, Times Square in New York, both unique, iconic landmarks of the world. But in Taipei Sansha, a town steeped in 200 years of history, the Zhoushir Temple and traditional ceramic arts have inspired the creation of a one-of-a-kind residential boulevard.Where art from around the world takes center stage. And residents can appreciate the artwork from right outside their homes. This is true happiness. Sansha's Art Boulevard, a great place to live.
云雄耶鲁2668-3456
这是乔治，一心打造格兰利威单一风味。这也是乔治，一意钟爱格兰利威无二口感。当乔治国王签下了这张单一无二的合法执照，格兰利威自此定义了当今单一纯麦的风味，为单一纯麦利威。格兰利威，单一无二。
洗脸更要控油，凉快爽快痛快 ，Men's Legend for Men 控油爽肤水。
再自尊21点，比手气还要比胆识。你手里的牌几点？
我21点，你呢？
我自尊21点。倒数对招在 Yes777，赶快上网搜寻，来自尊。
你不论在下几任小时候阿光你的
真的会回甘哦，
哎呀，100%全麦酿造，
大破甘饮台湾啤酒卖，
台啤开卖啦，开瓶赠奖送，独家苏打绿纪念赠品送给你，还有再来一瓶哦，详情请见台湾烟酒官网。
In the 1960s, massive house building programs were transforming cities. The government set a target of 300,000 new homes per year. And in true 60s style, they commissioned new futuristic designs.
The new vogue in the world of architecture was stark, hard-edged blocks of concrete and glass, and not everyone approved. Ian Fleming, the author of the James Bond novels, was one who certainly hated it.So much so that he named one of James Bond's adversaries, Goldfinger, after the leading 1960s architect, Erno Goldfinger.
This is one of the most famous Goldfinger designs, Trellick Tower in West London, a 31-storey block of flats with a separate lift tower. It's either iconic or an eyesore, depending on your point of view.
Personally, I have to say I'm with Fleming on this one.
With new homes and more money to spend, the number of household gadgets rocketed. Instamatic cameras, Super 8 film, stereos, and the nation now had 15 million televisions and over 4 million telephones. But the boom in phones and televisions was causing a huge problem for the country's communications network. Britain was linked by old cables and manned telephone exchanges, which couldn't cope with the massive increase in demand. To keep the phones of the future ringing, we needed a technological revolution.
Welcome to the hub of the revolutionary system, London's Post Office Tower, a tower for telecommunications, and a darker, more secret role in Britain's Cold War defence.
This stylish 60s building is also a great big British machine.
The lift is now travelling at 1,400 feet per minute.
At 188 metres, it was the tallest building in London at the time. Designed to make use of a technology called microwave transmission. Microwaves are high-frequency radio waves that could be used to transmit 10 times as much data as the old cables.
This is the business end of the tower. These horns behind me are the original 1960s microwave dishes.
They sent out microwave signals to other towers roughly 25 miles away, which could beam the signals on across a network of 130 relay stations around the country. This entire network was monitored from inside the Post Office Tower, down on floor 14.
It's like time has stood still in here. It's absolutely fantastic. Virtually nothing has changed since it was built by the Ministry of Building and Public Works back in 1965.
I feel like I'm in a time warp, surrounded by perfectly preserved electronics from a different age.
Now that is a control board and a half. Fantastic mesh on the old tester number 192B/WKC/1. The cord tester. I'm not wearing my cords today. I have no clue what these things mean, but listen. You know that switch is on. Nowadays you get these horrible electronic press, is it on or is it off kind of switch, whereas these days you knew it was on. Gain normal. We'll leave it there.
Without these electronics, you actually had to book a slot with an operator to make a long-distance call.
Do you know, there are many sounds that conjure up the past, and that, to me, is certainly one of the sounds of the 60s. In addition to the Beatles and the Stones and the Dave Clark Five. And...
With these machines and the new microwave network, the tower could handle over 150,000 telephone calls at once.
Don't think I'd like to rewire this lot.
Computers received, processed and transmitted the calls. Everything was done electronically. Only a few humans were needed for maintenance, and working in the tower could be, well, a lonely job.
This is the Post Office Tower. Come in, Portsmouth. Hello, Harry. Do you like to be beside the seaside? How's Wendy? Give her my love. Goodbye.
But it wasn't just telephone calls beaming out of the microwave transmitters. The tower transformed the nation's television. The old cables could only transmit two channels of fuzzy black and white pictures. The microwave network could send out 40 channels at once. Now live television, outside broadcasts and simultaneous transmission to the entire country were possible.
Through these transmitters passed some classic TV moments from the decade, like the 1966 World Cup final. They think it's all over. It is now. And of course, Britain's first colour TV image, Wimbledon 1967. Ooh, I say, what an absolute peach of a shot by the Australian.
And on the 21st of July 1969, the Post Office Tower brought the British public the mind-blowing images of man's first step on the moon.
Let's see who's on the line.
Just blow off the 50-year-old dust first. The Soviets are coming. When?
The Cold War arms race was escalating. In 1962, US and Soviet tensions came to a head in the Cuban Missile Crisis, making the fear of nuclear war more real than ever. A war that the post office tower was designed to survive.
Interestingly, one of the main reasons for making the tower round is so that it had more chance of withstanding a nuclear blast.
It was thought that the curved shape would deflect the shockwaves better than the sides of a square building. The hope was that while conventional cables would be easily destroyed, the new microwave network could be kept operational, keeping Prime Minister Harold Wilson in contact with the outside world.
The hope was that if a bomb did hit Britain, the Prime Minister, safely smuggled deep inside his bunker in the Wiltshire Hills, could make a distress call via this tower to the rest of the world. Something along the lines of,
help! Now, where were we, Mary? Got any tobacco?
The distress signal would be beamed down across the country to Goonhilly Satellite Station, then up to Telstar, the world's first communication satellite, and then down to, well, whoever was left and might be listening.
Because of its Cold War defense connections, it was part of the Official Secrets Act. So, the post office tower was never actually marked on a map. There, blank. Now there's absolutely no chance of anyone ever finding a huge tower with massive satellite dishes attached to the side, is there?
In fact, it wasn't just a rubbish official secret. It was actually a tourist attraction with a revolving restaurant on floor 34. Even Soviet dignitaries were invited to come and enjoy a prawn cocktail and a glass of Blue Nun.
This was the UK's first and only revolving restaurant. This is where the cool, the rich, the sophisticated would come and hang out and generally look groovy as they let the evening skyline slowly drift by over a vodka martini or two, shaken, not stirred.
Over 4.5 million people flocked to the Butlins-owned restaurant to get a taste of the high life, including the leading stars of the day.
The background, the greatest city in the world. Here, it would seem, the sky is really the limit.
It might have seemed impressively high-tech at the time, but in fact, it was rather straightforward.
Down through a trapdoor and underneath the chic restaurant, it looks more like a fairground ride.
So here we have a fairly modest-looking electric motor, which via this gearbox turns a fairly meaty-looking cog, which drives the outer revolving section, all 30 tons of it, which sits on 48 what look to me like giant shopping trolley wheels. It looks like an original motor, doesn't it? So it looks 60s with all the ribbing and Radicon announced on the top of the gearbox there. Made in England, bull. Yeah, good stuff. Solid.
But in 1980, the restaurant closed to the public when its franchise ran out and London's only revolving dining room ground to a halt. But does it still work? Yes, it does. The little 2-horsepower engine still powers the big cogwheel and rotates the entire 30-ton floor 360 degrees in just 22 minutes.
Now, where's my cocktail?
The spinning restaurant was the icing on the cake of a truly revolutionary great British machine. But communications wasn't the only network getting a radical overhaul in a modernized Britain. In the 1960s, 4,000 miles of railway lines were closed down, while 1,000 miles of a new breed of road were being built, the motorway. These new fast roads created a fantastic opportunity for the road haulage industry to take lucrative freight business away from the rail companies. Unfortunately, the typical lorries of the day were slow, noisy bone shakers with cold, cramped cabs. Not great for long-distance trucking. They needed their own revolution. This is a 1967 Leyland Super Comet, a 60s workhorse that transformed the life of the modern lorry driver. It was the first lorry to be designed with the comfort of the driver in mind. For safety at high speeds on the motorway, it had radial ply tyres that were puncture resistant and powerful air brakes. But the most groundbreaking feature of the Super Comet was the cab.
There we go, tilt cab. Absolutely revolutionary, instant access to the engine. Mechanic's dream, really, compared to the older trucks, where you had to sort of reach down the side for changes or, for bigger jobs, drop the engine out of the bottom of the truck.
But the really revolutionary part was the ergonomically designed interior.
Right, ergonomic. Designed for maximum comfort, efficiency, safety, and ease of use, especially in the workplace. In a lorry? It's extraordinary.
But just how comfortable is it? To find out, I'm going to take it for a spin with classic lorry enthusiast John Gowler, who's owned this truck for 40 years.
Hey, look at that. Great. All right, John.
Yep.
So it's right across
from...
No,
no,
is it?
No. Just there.
All right.
The non-synchromesh gears on this old girl might take some getting used to.
You're not being fired, then.
Huh?
You're not being fired. You're all right.
We're third?
Yeah, you're all right.
So this is a crash box, so gear changing is a bit of an art, which I'm just about getting hold of. What's that? Is that...
I finally got me gears sorted and can now appreciate the finer details of the ergonomic design.
Yeah, the driving position on this Super Comet is absolutely superb. Plenty of visibility. I've got everything all around me, easily accessible. The indicators over here. Power steering is just a joy to use compared to earlier trucks. Handbrake there. Even got a heater. And that separates trucks, of course, from the modern era, from the old era when you just had to wear a nice stout coat. And although you've got the engine right beside you, it's not really that intrusive. You know, at 55 miles an hour, you can still have a decent conversation without having to bellow.
The Super Comet set a new standard for British lorries. In these revolutionary cabs, drivers took on much longer haulage routes on the new motorways. And they were built to last. This one's completed an amazing 700,000 miles.
Yeah, there we are with the big Leyland logo that so many people associate with unreliability. And that is an opinion, really, that's based on the cars. But really, when you look at this truck, Leyland 400 engine, seven times around the clock, 300,000 miles in the first 6 years, and after that, just piston rings and shells. That was all that was changed. And it was ready for another 400,000 miles. Absolutely brilliant.
By the end of the 60s, with lorries like this, the road haulage business increased by 60%. And the era of the modern long-distance truck driver was born. But the road haulage companies weren't having it all their own way. An even more revolutionary machine saw thousands of their customers go DIY.
Our safety books have been written in blood. They have been written in blood because somebody has died.
在三十多公尺高的地方，很一触碰就会被电死的电线，距离只有几公分。
You lose focus is when you die, or you kill someone else. That's just the way it is.
这是世上最危险的工作之一。
Most people, when you tell them what we're doing, think we're insane.
全新系列《危险讨生活》，星期二晚上九点，国家地理频道。
哇，
好阳光的哈斯啊！
鲜奶搭配阳光起司，烤成金黄哈斯，加上烟熏鲔鱼沙拉，早餐就是要烟熏鲔鱼起司哈斯。还有百思集也回来喽。
39.6万的缓酿工艺，只为淬炼每一滴丰润纯玉，体验完美平衡的口感。The Singleton of Glenmore， 苏格登单一纯麦威士忌，缓酿丰醇，完美平衡。
喂，在忙吗？
我正在整理公司车辆的牌照税单，等一下要去银行缴税。
哎，用银行账户约定转账纳税，安全又方便，不但办理一次，年年适用，而且在限缴日最后一天才扣款哦。
那我要赶快去税捐机关申请，明年就省事喽。
除了利用银行账户约定转账外，您还可以用 ATM、信用卡或到便利商店等方式缴税。现在11月2日前缴纳夏季营业用汽车及使用牌照税。财政部提醒您。
어서오세요
无穷乐趣，要是能有翻身术就好了。首尔的乐趣怎会有尽头呢？
无穷乐趣尽在首尔。
咦，他不是赌神周润发吗？
至尊百家乐，连赌神也不缺席。发哥，上了桌是对手，下了桌是朋友。Yes 777，至尊百家乐够呛，赶快上网搜寻，乃至尊。
October 6th, 1965. The launch day for a vehicle that might surprise many as one of my greatest ever British machines. The wonderful, ubiquitous, love it or hate it, Ford Transit. The world's most successful van. A success measured in over 5 million vans produced around the world.
One of the reasons for the spectacular global success of the Transit was the sheer number of versions you could buy. Not only could you buy a standard panel van, but you could also buy a beautiful camper van like this supreme example here. A milk delivery van, an ice cream van, a special bodied parcels van like this one. You could have a drop side tipper, you could have a high top long wheelbase, you could have a minibus. In 68, you could have a 4x4, you could have an ambulance, you could have a flatbed, or you could have a fire support vehicle, which is how this beautiful Transit started life.
When the first Transit came off the production line, this spacious, adaptable, easy to drive, powerful new vehicle was an instant hit. Within 1 month, Ford had £3.6 million worth of orders. What was the secret to this success? One simple idea, to produce a van that was as easy to hop in and drive as a car.
The Transit simply blew the opposition away. Its greater width gave it superb handling. It was also the first van to be fitted with a floor gear change, both of which gave it a car-like driving experience. But the thing that really separated the Transit from the pack
was the Essex V4 engine. This beauty here pushed the Transit along at cruising speeds in excess of 70 miles an hour when the opposition were running out of breath at 50.
And where else would you find that torquey Essex V4? In Ford's classic British bad boy racer, the Capri.
And I don't know about you, but as far as vans go, I think it's a bit of a looker.
This was a van that shouted, "Get out of my way, I'm the new king of the road." And with a car-type gearbox, brakes and steering wheel, it was a wonderful, affordable DIY alternative to hiring a trucking company. For all sorts of businessmen and a new wave of entrepreneurs, like Richard Branson, who started his first business transporting records in a Transit.
As an alternative to using a haulage company to move your stuff, the easy-to-drive Transit was also perfect for the independent businessman.
Whether you were a tradesman or wanting to make a quick getaway.
Yeah, the fast-moving Transit was the vehicle of choice for bank robbers.
In the 1960s, more bank jobs were done in Transits than in cars. Like everyone else, bank robbers liked the way you could stash it full and scream away from the scene of the crime.
Looks like the Rozzers are on us, Bob. I'm gonna give it some beans.
The police even had to update their cars to keep up with the Transit.
There we go, look at that. Cornering like a car, driving like a car, and we're getting away nicely. Massively impressed. I've only been in this vehicle for a few seconds.
Keep up. Catch the tranny if you can.
Yeah, it's all gone quiet, Bob. My middle name is Sterling. Absolutely well impressed with this. It just feels so tight, feels like a new vehicle. Feels like a brand new vehicle.
Spacious, fast, and a joy to drive. The Transit van. It's impossible to imagine life in Britain without it. Uh-oh, I got so into the wonders of this machine, the Rozzers have gone and nicked me. Sorry, Bob.
In an age of mini everything, this is modern mini transport.
The 60s were fast becoming a golden era for invention. Even the craziest ideas were getting their 15 minutes of fame. And one great British inventor who had been struggling for years to be taken seriously finally had his day.
Tins of coffee, kitchen scales, a hairdryer. Not the ideal starting point for the invention of a revolutionary machine, you're probably thinking, but
if we put 2 ounces on the scales and then blow hot air straight onto the scales, we'll see that it lifts the 2 ounces. Now, if we try this with 4 ounces on the scales, it struggles.
So what you do is take a reasonably large tin and place another tin inside it and then blow hot air between the two tins, creating an annular jet that produces a much more powerful downward force. Here we go. There we have hoverage. We're lifting 4 ounces. And that's the basic principle of the hovercraft.
Inventor Christopher Cockerill first carried out this experiment in his garden shed in 1953 and became convinced he could make boats that could fly.
To get his idea to fly, Cockerill needed to convince the people with money that his quirky invention would work and be useful. This model, made out of canvas and wood, was the very first hovercraft prototype built by Cockerill in 1955.
His flying boat had many admirers, but when trying to raise the finance, he hit an unexpected problem.
The Admiralty said it was an aircraft and not a boat, so they weren't interested. The Air Ministry said it was a boat and not an aircraft, so they weren't interested. And the Army just weren't interested.
But Cockerell was determined to see his idea come alive. He knew his craft had a totally unique selling point.
If I try and push the hovercraft across the ground like that, it's actually quite difficult to do. If we produce our cushion of air between the hovercraft and the ground, it lifts the hovercraft, and then there's no friction between the craft and the ground, and it moves around really easily, like so. No friction at all.
And after 6 years, his belief in this frictionless craft paid off.
Inspired by the fanciful flying saucer stories, the current crop of inventors is out to make rumor reality, it seems, as with Britain's new hovercraft.
The National Research Development Council provided the cash, and in 1959, Cockerell's first hovercraft finally took to the water.
The idea may seem outlandish now, but the inventor predicts someday hovercraft the size of the Queen Mary will cross the Atlantic at 100 miles an hour.
Now, I've been told that your average hovercraft exerts about as much pressure on the ground as a seagull standing on one leg. So, to prove the gentle touch of the mighty hovercraft, we're going to put it to the egg test.
Let the experiment begin. And my hovercraft of choice for this demonstration? Nothing less than the 1969 two-man Hoverhawk that Ranulph Fiennes took on his exploration of the White Nile.
So yes, we're in a bit of a period time machine here. It's very 60s, it's very Thunderbirds, it's very sort of Danger Man, sort of early James Bond and the Saint. All these things are conjured up by sitting in this extraordinary machine. It's powered by three motorcycle engines ostensibly, one for lift and two for propulsion. I'm going to try and fly over 30 eggs. Wish me luck.
Frankly, it's not the easiest thing to steer.
Well, on the face of it, our hoverhawk friend here has failed the egg test, it has to be said. But look at this. Look at this. I would say that the skirt actually caused the damage to those eggs, and the actual downward, inward pressure created by the hovercraft has actually not damaged these eggs at all. And look. Look at them, they're all intact. They're all intact. So in fact, our experiment has been an absolute success.
The ability to hover makes these machines fast, efficient, and incredibly versatile. They're the perfect amphibian, flying over water, sandbanks, snow, and ice. Hovercraft can access 75% of the world's coastline, compared to only 5% for boats. Cockerell's invention was an instant hit with the press and the public. And in 1961, aircraft producers Saunders Roe were commissioned to start building commercial hovercraft.
This is number 25 of the first production hovercraft built for commercial use. The 1965 10-ton Saunders Roe Nautical, or SRN-6.
It could carry 38 passengers, cruising at 50 knots, 57 miles an hour. And of course, you need some pretty beefy engine power to create the lift and propulsion for a 10-ton machine.
Up here we have a single Rolls-Royce known gas turbine aircraft engine. This one engine powers two propellers that drive the hovercraft forward, and it also powers this huge fan that blows air underneath the hovercraft to lift it.
So, this one should be a doddle to drive. Time for a lesson with pilot Tony Byrne.
So, Tony, here you are, a proper hovercraft pilot. Let me know a few do's and don'ts then about driving one of these.
You press the left-hand pedal forward and the craft will turn to the left, which is port. If you look, we've got the turbine.
Then there's
off.
The engine revs, fuel distribution controls, propeller speed, rudder direction, skirt height, dumper valves. Doesn't sound like the easiest machine to master.
Well, would you like to have a go?
I would actually, yes.
Right. Let's get you in the seat.
Okay. Right.
Okay, feet in the rudder stirrups, yeah?
Yep.
The larger the rubber skirt, the higher the hovercraft flies. On full power, the SRN6 lifts to over 7 feet above the ground.
Okay, so we're up to about 13 and a half.
Bring us slightly back.
All the engine power is being directed to the fan pushing 70,000 litres of air under the craft per second. And very quickly, we're up.
19,000 RPM now.
Hold there. You feel it dancing?
Yes, we're hovering now, aren't we? Yeah.
Right up on hover, dancing on the air.
The frictionless hovercraft turns incredibly easily. You can spin a 360-degree turn on the spot. Or head for the nearest fence, which is looking more likely in my case.
Feel it moving?
Yeah.
No eggs broken, but I think I'll leave it to the expert now. Hovercraft have been built in all shapes and sizes, from little one-person explorers to the biggest in the world, the SRN4, which used to carry up to 55 cars and 424 passengers across the English Channel at up to 70 miles an hour in just 22 minutes. The great popularity of Cockerill's invention has spread all over the world. A little bit of British genius that can still reach the places that other machines simply can't. But there's one machine that, above all others, I think encapsulates the inventiveness, revolutionary design, and pure joy of British engineering in the 60s.
It's been called the most beautiful car ever built. No, it's not a Ferrari, or an Aston Martin, or a Mercedes. It is, of course, the Jaguar E-Type.
It has everything you could ever want in a car. Looks, comfort, handling, and power.
There's a raw power from the 3.8-litre Jaguar engine that gives magnificent acceleration and superb high-speed cruising.
The secret to this car's success lies in her stunning good looks. The E-Type's curves are the perfect marriage of form and function. The design came from a heritage of spectacular racing cars. At a time when aerodynamics were starting to dominate racing, and Jaguar were regular winners with their extraordinary streamlined C and D types designed by Malcolm Sayer. Malcolm Sayer was an aeronautical engineer who brought the aerodynamic design and monocoque construction techniques from the aircraft industry to the world of racing cars. Then Jaguar set him his greatest challenge, to take his brilliant work with racing cars and incorporate it into a road-legal production sports car.
11月国家地理频道 超大建筑狂想曲卷土重来 这一季更大更惊人 5个土著到美国拍纪录片惊喜不断 摩登原始人游美国 12年来纳粹大规模夺取及破坏艺术品史无前例欧洲珍宝蒙难记见证一起震惊世人的血腥杀戮透视内幕雾霾恐怖攻击11月精彩震撼尽在国家地理频道若不是成果太迷人我们不会坚持与白小时的等候历经39万6000秒的缓酿工艺 只为淬炼每一滴风润纯欲。
体验完美平衡的口感。The Singleton of Glenmore， 苏格登单一纯麦威士忌，缓酿丰醇，完美平衡。
上网，那就加入中华电信 M 酷299，让你手机上网吃到饱，每月再送你150元，音乐游戏任你玩。现在参加 M 酷购机专案，Sony Ericsson Yaris 只要7490元，再送 M 酷无限上网3个月。
大哥，我们谁才是真正的至尊赌神 ？Yes 777，至尊德州扑克，等你来挑战！赶快上网搜寻，乃至尊！
全台中热情总动员，
加加加！
哈！哈！全台湾选手大集合，
加加加！
哈！哈！哈！
台湾好运在台中，
加加加！
加加加！
98年全国运动会，
来见证
台湾加！
不止洗脸，更要控油，凉快爽快痛快 ，Men's Legend for Men 控油爽肤水。
In the 1960s, engineer Peter Wilson worked with Jaguar's Malcolm Sayer and observed how he created the extraordinary profile of the E-Type.including a little-known aerodynamic technique that Sayer secretly used behind closed doors.
He stuck little pieces of wall, maybe about 2-3 inches long, a piece of sellotape across, all facing the rearward direction. The whole car would be covered in them. He would observe the way in which the wool tufts reacted.
Here in my wind tunnel, we can see exactly how it works. Turn on the fan,and the strips of wool reveal exactly how the air is flowing over the surface. As you can see, my strips of wool are flowing nicely alongside the car. But the genius of the wool test experiment is that you can remove the car from the wind tunnel and put it on the test track. And that's exactly what Sayer did. From the chase car, Sayer took hundreds of photographs. Whether it was going down a straight, going into a corner, going through a chicane,into a headwind, even in the rain. Sayer analyzed all his photos and applied some extremely complex aerodynamic mathematical formulae that totally baffled his colleagues.
He had this calculator that he'd pull the handle on and it'd whir away and some figures would come out.
And yeah, yeah.
Probably only he could understand. Now, his drawings, they were on a drawing sheet, but all they were massive figures. It was totally unique in the industry at the time, his method.
These figures were converted into the magical shape of the E-Type, and the head of Jaguar, William Lyons, proudly presented his designer's masterwork to the world's press at the 1961 Geneva Motor Show.
The car rolls up. Here it is, gentlemen. So they're standing there, their jaws are on the ground. Then a typical Sir William fashion, what about the cost? And, this is the price.And at £2,200, all taxes paid in UK for the fixed head car, it was an affordable supercar.
Yeah, absolute perfection.
Absolutely.
With standard Jaguar components, including engine, gearbox, and rear axle, and cleverly designed production techniques, the E-Type was produced for an unbelievably low price.
And thanks to those magnificent aerodynamics and the great Jaguar engine, that prize brought you getting on for 150 miles an hour of heaven on earth.
But in a decade famous for amazing sports cars, how does the affordable E-Type compete with the best from around the world? Let's find out. Another car maker famous for giving bang for your buck was the American Corvette. And this 1963 Stingray is one of their most sought-after models.
I'm looking at a Wurlitzer. It's a 50 spaceship. No, I'm in an American diner, surely. Everything about this car is big, brash, and loud. For Christ's sakes, it's American!
$4,037 in the day for a 360 horsepower American muscle car that was great in a straight line. What about that great German icon, the Porsche 911? A hugely successful sports car with a 25-year production run in classic form. But almost twice the price of the E-Type and Stingray.
This is a fuss-free machine that gets you from A to B damn fast. And that's it. It's clinical. It's functional. I suppose for the non-German, driving one of these is the nearest you get to actually feeling what it's like to be a German.
Great handling and performance, but not exactly a stunner. For sexy good looks, Ferrari has got to be a contender. This is a 1960 250 GT, a class beauty outside and in.
The interior of this car for me is just typical Italian. You know, from little things like the Art Deco rocker switch, the sculptured door handles, the attractively shaped mirror, the suede dashboard top that doesn't reflect in the windscreen on bright days.
You look fantastic driving one of these until you break down. She had a pretty shaky reliability record. And for the same price, you could buy three E-Types.
Driving the E-Type, I feel that here we have a car that takes elements from all the other contenders. But the E-Type has something else. Something indefinable.
And if, just if, I was judging a 1960s Miss World competition for beautiful sports cars.
So, after much careful, indeed agonizing consideration, Miss World Sports Car 1960s is Miss United Kingdom.
Never in doubt, really.
Looks, comfort, handling, and power. It's got it all. Being a huge Jaguar fan, maybe I'm a little biased. But I don't think the great Enzo Ferrari was. He called the E-Type the most beautiful car ever made. In 14 years, Jaguar built over 72,000 E-Types. A fantastic British export, seducing people across the world.
For me, this car embodies the great British machines of the 60s. Style, beauty, and ingenious engineering. And for the first time, you didn't have to be part of the rich elite to afford one.
The 60s embraced radical new designs for an era which changed the rules and set new standards. With machines that even now, 50 years on, still look totally revolutionary.
欧洲村紧邻新庄复读新，樊登。 全新完工，2994-9900。
长荣家具全馆装修大出清，清擦下沙全面一折起，独立桶床垫只要1790。长荣家具保证全国最低价，还可享有分期。